All right, we're going to continue on from the last presentation. I actually lost that presentation, so I had to kind of redraw what we have here. And what we were doing was building up the electrons in bromine. And bromine has 35 protons, so there's 35 electrons in a neutral atom of bromine. And we were talking about how you place the electrons in bromine. So what we have here is we've talked about the energy levels. The energy levels are represented on the periodic table as periods. And so in the first period, there's only hydrogen and helium, and that's what these two electrons here represent. And then the next period, there's lithium and beryllium's electron in the S sublevel and the S orbital. Remember, the lines represent orbitals, the boxes represent sublevels, and then the N values out here represent the levels. And what we also noticed was that once we finish beryllium, we jump all the way across the periodic table to group 13. And if we look at group 13 out to the end, boron to neon, we see there's six elements there. And each orbital can hold two electrons, so that's what gives us an indication that there are three orbitals in between group 13 and group 18. And so we placed an electron spin up for boron, carbon, nitrogen, and then we go back and pair those, oxygen, fluorine, and neon, and that finishes up the 2p sublevel. Now, if we look at the periodic table, we're at neon, and what we really have represented up here, we've just finished these eight electrons up here in our atomic diagram. And now a neon tells us that the next element on the periodic table is sodium. We start the third energy level, third period, third energy level. And there are three sublevels here. There's the S with its one orbital. There's the P with its three orbitals. And the D has five. Now, if you get lost and you forget how many D has, look at the transition elements in period 4. Scandium group in group 3, scandium in period 4, scandium number 21 over to zinc 30 in group 12. Count up the number of elements there. There are 10. Divide that by 2. That tells you how many orbitals should be in that sublevel. So this is the S, this is the P, this is the D. And again, where we got that was L equal to 0 is S, L equals to 1 is P, and L equal to 2 is D. And again, these represent the probability shapes of where the electron will be in relation to the nucleus. The S is spherical in probability, the P is dumbbell shape, and the D is a clover leaf shape. Looks something like that. All right. So we have sodium goes here. It's the first element in the third period. Magnesium goes here, second element in the third period. Now, here's something to remember. The first two groups, group 1 and 2, they always fill up the S sublevel. At magnesium, we jump over to group 13, aluminum, which aluminum's in, and we go aluminum, silicon, phosphorus, and then we go back and pair sulfur, chlorine, argon. That's the P sublevel. All right, so we just added those eight electrons up here in the atomic diagram. All right, now from argon number 18, we need to start the fourth level. And again, it's the S. And we know that there's four sublevels in the S. Whatever the N equals here, that's how many sublevels are. There's the S, there's the P with the 3, there's the D with the 5, and there's an F, and it actually has 7 in it. We're not going to talk about the F in Chem 140, so don't worry about the F. So we're at argon. We go potassium and calcium. Again, the first two groups always fill up the S. But watch what happens here. We're no longer jumping all the way to group 13. We have a bridge between the S block, groups 1 and 2, and the P block between 13 and 18. So we're now looking at the groups 3 through 12. And remember, this is called the transition elements. And the transition elements are always a period behind the one they're in. So what we have right now is we have 2, 8, 8, and 2. The 2 there is represented there. All right. Now, watch what happens. We drop back to the third energy level, and scandium's electron goes here. Titanium, vanadium, chromium, manganese, iron, cobalt, nickel, copper, zinc, and that takes care of the 10 here, and that gives us 18 total now in the third period or the third energy level. We pop back out the other side. We got gallium, germanium, arsenic, and then selenium and bromine. Now notice, we had 2, we just added 5, and that gives us a total of 7 in the outer shell now. So that is an orbital diagram for bromine. You say, do I have to do this every time? No, there is an easier way, and that's called electron configuration. And in electron configuration, you just write down what you just did. You got 1s2. That fills up these two electrons here. Then we filled up the 2s2. Then we filled up the 2p6. And then we filled up the 3s2. Then we did the 3p6. Then we did the 4s2. Then we did the 3d10. And then we finished off with 4p5. So this electron configuration is a shorthand way of writing an orbital diagram. That's what this is called down here. And it takes up a lot less space. In fact, it can even be done better if we look at the last time we crossed P6, which is at the end of a period, because when we get to the noble gases, there's a total of 8 electrons in the outer shell, and there's 2 plus 6. So we're looking for a P6, and the 3P6 tells us that we just crossed argon. So instead of writing all that out, we can put in brackets argon, and then write the rest of it. 4s2, 3d10, 4p5. This is called a noble gas core electron configuration. Oops, noble gas core electron configuration. All right. So this is an example of classifying where the electrons are located in relation to the nucleus. We had the atomic diagram to begin with here. The advantage of the atomic diagram, it's quick, it's easy, and you can quickly tell how many electrons is in the outer shell. But if we want more detail as to where the electrons are located, we do an orbital diagram. Now the advantage of an orbital diagram is we can quickly see which electrons are paired and which ones are unpaired. Like we can see right here, there's an unpaired electron. And it shows the building up principle, starting at the ground floor with one room, start to the second floor with two rooms, and so forth. But it takes up a lot of space, and it takes up quite a bit of time. So we like the electron configuration. It's quicker, it's more compact, it's easier to write. Doesn't quite give us as much information. You have to know that there are 3 orbitals, and that in the p sublevel here, and that one of those electrons is unpaired. And then even quicker or faster is to write the noble gas core electron configuration. I hope this helps.